Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Hebron Baptist Church. My name is Tyler Williams. This is my wife, Brandy, and we're excited to be leading you in worship this morning. Let's turn to the Word of God as we begin and get our hearts and minds ready for worship. This is Psalm 118, verses 21 through 24. It says, I will give thanks to you, Lord, because you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This came from the Lord. It is wondrous in our sight. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Would you stand with us as we begin to worship this morning?
We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Hallelujah, thy glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thy glory. Revive us again. For thy Spirit of light, who has shown us our Savior and scattered our night. Hallelujah, thy glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thy glory. Revive us again. Fill each heart with thy love. May each soul be rekindled with fire from above. Hallelujah, thy glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thy glory. Revive us again. Hallelujah, thy glory. Hallelujah. From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Who has told every lightning bolt where it should go? Or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow? Who imagined the sun and gives source to its light? Yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. None can fathom indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable, the depths of my heart, and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God.
You may be seated.
Father God, thank you so much for who you are, Lord. God, for sending your son to die for us. Lord, giving us eternal life. Father, I pray that as we continue to engage in worship with you this morning, Lord, as we give, God, we're reminded of all that you've given us. And Lord, that every bit of it is yours. Father, may we give with a joyful heart this morning. And Lord, as we continue to hear from you through song and through your word, Lord, may you continue to work in our hearts. God, open our eyes, our minds, and our ears to everything that you have to say. Lord, do a work in us this morning. And when we leave, may us glorify you to the world. We ask all these things in Christ's name. Amen. For the scripture reading this morning, I'm going to be in Romans 8, verses 1 through 4. Paul says this when writing to the church of Rome. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free, and in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. By sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you, we come to you humbly, and we worship you this morning. Lord, be with us and fill this room as we continue to seek you. In Jesus' name, amen.
From heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. by his blood and in his name. In his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of kings. Oh, praise forever to the King of kings.
Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in hell. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. In life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Here in the power of Christ we stand.
Amen. You can be seated.
All right. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, I hope you do. You can open up to Matthew chapter 6. We're going to be continuing from where we were last week. All right. How's everybody doing this morning? I trust that y'all had a good Thanksgiving. Yeah? Me too. We ate a lot and traveled a lot. Got back here at Denham Springs almost at midnight last night, but or I guess more so 11 p.m., but we're thankful to be able to go home and see family. I hope you all had a great time, but I'm glad to be back here this morning with you all. As you can see, the title of the sermon this morning is Pray Like This. We're going to be going into probably one of the most famous passages in Scripture, and that would be the Lord's Prayer, and I'm excited to dive into this with you this morning. For those of you who don't know me, my name's Corey McKinney. I'm the student pastor here. If I haven't met you yet, come holler at me after service, or just like raise your hand up like after service, and I'll see if I can see you. Might run over to you. We'll do something like that. But anyway, let's begin. Last week, Travis went over what it meant to be a cheerful giver. So if you're here last week, you got to hear from the beginning of this passage, Matthew 6, 1 through 4. And in that sermon, he broke down a word used to describe those who stand in the synagogues and the streets and draw attention to themselves but before doing something that most would consider righteous. A very specific word, Jesus is going to use it another time here, and that word is this. The term is hypocrite, and it's a word that carries with it the imagery of wearing multiple masks, playing different parts, and being deceptive about who we really are. So Jesus firmly warned against this. Right? He firmly warned against this in those first four verses. He's going to do it again here in just a moment. And instead of telling us to do that, he continues to instruct us on what it's like to walk and live righteously before the Lord. So this morning, we're going to continue to hear from Christ as he discusses prayer, its purpose, and how to pray with his disciples. Let's read Matthew 6, 5 through 15. Jesus says this, "And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners that they may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door, and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who is in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray then like this, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." Jesus continues, "For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses." Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for this morning, Lord. We're gathered here, reading out of your word, Father. Speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so there's three commands that Jesus gives here. This morning, two of them are, don't be like this, don't be like that, and then the other one is, pray like this. This is where you get the title of the sermon. So I'm going to use those commands to give us three takeaways, and our first one is this morning. Our prayers are not for the praise of others, all right? So, once again, like last week, Jesus says in the first four verses that the hypocrites stand on the corners and they sound trumpets and they have this like call to action where all these people can kind of see them and then they do something, right? In this particular instance, he was talking about giving. They would call all these people around to see them and then they would give to the needy or they would give to the poor. Or they would take something that they had and give it to somebody else. And that act was for the glorification of who? Themselves, exactly. Right? So as we read 5 through 6 again, look at what Jesus says. When you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. See, it's interesting that Jesus would refer to the synagogues and the streets again, right? Travis talked about last week how, you know, it's kind of debated on whether or not they would have actually carried a trumpet around with them or whether they would have just had this really loud, like, call, like, hey, everybody, look at what I'm doing, basically, is what they would have done. But it's interesting that he refers to the synagogues and the streets again because it wasn't very common for prayer to happen in the streets at that time for Jewish believers, right? It wasn't common for them to practice prayer in the streets. Most of the time, prayer took place in front of the synagogues. And as a matter of fact, for you to be the one to pray in front of everybody, in front of the synagogues, was like a high honor, right? It was a really big deal. To be invited to be the one to pray was a mark of distinction among your congregation. However, as we see set up in the life of Daniel, when he had certain times that he would pray throughout the day, somebody who would have observed those prayer times strictly would have had an afternoon prayer. And if they had that afternoon hour of prayer, when everything would have been busy in the streets and in the markets, they could time their journey to the temple in such a way that they would accidentally not make it to the temple in time, right? So they wouldn't make it there. They're like, oh no, what do I do? I guess I've got to stand right here and pray as loud as I can for everybody to see me, right? Got to do that. Now, as they were doing that, who do you think that that prayer was for? Somebody said it earlier, themselves. Themselves. It wasn't for God. It was for the praise of themselves. This is what John Stott had to say about it. What he, Jesus, says of the hypocrites sounds fine at first. They love to pray. They love to pray. But unfortunately, it's not prayer which they love, nor the God that they are supposed to pray to. No, they love themselves and the opportunity which public praying gives them to parade themselves. The kind of prayer that the hypocrites were engaging in might as well have been considered a moment of praise, not to the Father, but to themselves. And when I was thinking about this warning here from Jesus this week, I was reminded of a parable that Jesus told in Luke 18. This is Luke 18, 9 through 14. I think we've got it up on the screen. We do. All right, Luke 18, 9 through 14. He also told, this is Jesus speaking, or Jesus about to speak, he, being Jesus, also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. Listen to this. Two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, God, I thank you that I am not like the other man, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector here. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I get. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift his eyes up to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. God forbid we ever come before the Lord with the thought that we are higher than either the one who we are praying for or the one we are praying beside. Hear me this morning. Believers, we must come before the Lord humbly, recognizing our positions as sinners in need of saving grace from the only one who can provide it, and that is the Lord. When we have an ulterior motive in our prayer life or any matter that we engage in spiritually that opposes the authenticity of worshiping the God we serve, then we transform our actions of praise and prayer into an exhibit for all to see how holy we are. When we do anything that lifts ourselves up, we're only praising ourselves because there's nothing holy about it. How can we pretend to be praising God when in reality we are concerned with the praise of men? This is what leads Christ to say, go into your room and shut the door when you pray. This serves to shut out the distractions and watching eyes of others that our flesh yearns to impress. And he shuts us in with God in a moment of intimacy with the one who has given us access to him directly. Now, Jesus was not telling us not to pray in public, because if that was the case, we couldn't meet here, right? There would be no point in gathering together and study of scripture and things like that for praying for one another. That's not what he's talking about. He was addressing our need to pray privately in our own prayer time and our own prayer lives, right? To come to the Lord one-on-one in our own daily lives. In other words, the only time you're praying should not be here at church or in your small groups and things like that. But you should be praying in your own lives, right? Going into your room quietly, shutting the door, and spending time with the Lord in conversation with him, praying to him. Our prayers should be genuine times devoted to seeking God, not times where the only time we're praying is when others can see us and they can praise us for it. The second takeaway is this morning. Our prayers should not be mechanical. Let's read verses 7 through 8 again. This is going to make sense in just a moment, I promise. 7 through 8. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. So the focus now has shifted to the Gentiles. Before it was the hypocrites, right? And now we have this different group of people, the Gentiles. He's making two comparisons here. This is why I use the Gentiles. It was common practice by the Gentiles to have a call to prayer where they would recite what they believed to be these magical incantations, right? They would lift up all these words, make these noises, get everything right. And they relied on this exact repetition of words to get the prayer right. All right, this was their way of doing it. They thought that if they messed any of this up, that the whole situation was ruined. It was like a ritual to them. They were lifting up these lofty phrases. They believed that this was the way that their pagan gods heard them. As they're doing this, they believe this is the only way that their gods would hear them because they said the right words, did the right things, had the call to prayer correctly. Now, look at what Jesus says in verse 8. Look back at it. What does he say? Don't be like them. Don't do that. Our prayers aren't magical sayings that can only be heard by God when we say them just right. That's not what prayer is. I think about it like this. When I played football in high school, 4 years in high school, every Friday night, we'd be in the locker room. Actually, we'd have pregame warm-up. We'd be out there, all of us, until I became a believer my sophomore year. I didn't engage in this anymore. But before that, I'd be out there cussing up a storm. We were going to whoop this team. You know, I can't believe that they would even mess with us. One of those years, we were talking all that trash, and we were garbage, right? We did it anyway. We'd be talking all this trash. We'd get in the locker room. Coach would give us this pregame speech. We'd be all fired up, right? It was all about us. It was all about us. And then, right before we walked out, everybody grabbed hands, took a knee, and one guy led us in the Lord's Prayer. Every Friday night, like clockwork. We sometimes treated it like it gave us some type of magical push to win the game, right? It's like, yeah, we've called on ourselves this whole time, right? We've done this, we've done that, but now let's call on the Lord to fill us up so we can go out and win this football game. Our prayers should not be treated like they're an insert a prayer and get a prize type of game. Because if we're not careful believers, we can do this in our own lives. And that's what Jesus is warning about. On the same note, our prayers should not be filled with lofty phrases and empty words. We don't have to fluff up our prayers to get the Lord to lean his ear to us. That's not the way it works, all right? Don't use the excuse that you don't know how to pray. You do. Just talk to him. Jesus is going to tell us in a minute when you come to the Father, say, "Our Father." That's personal. We can get caught up in thinking that if we miss a word or forget something in our prayers, that God won't hear us. That's simply not true. Jesus tells us that God knows what we need before we even come to him in the first place. So our attempts to use these words that are so big and so full of fluff, you don't have to do it. Just talk to him. He is readily available at every moment to hear from us. We have complete access to the Father because of what Christ has done for us on the cross. If we have placed our faith in Christ as Savior, we can have confidence that when we bring our request to the Father, that he will hear us. Believers, hear me on this. Talk to God regularly. Regularly. Scripture talks about praying without ceasing. Mean that in your lives. Talk to God regularly. No matter what, no matter what you've done, no matter how far you think you are off, no matter how bad of a day you've had where you've just messed everything up, and you're like, I don't even like myself right now. There's no way God wants to hear from me. Guess what? He does. He does. And he's readily available to hear from you. He's there waiting for you. Think about it like this. Autry, my daughter, she's 16 months old, or she will be on the 1st of December. And she's gotten really into fastening buckles lately, or at least attempting to. She hasn't quite got it, right? So she'll find like these little buckles on something. Maybe it's her car seat that we've left laying around, or something else that we have in the house. And she wants to buckle it together, but she starts struggling because she can't really do it on her own, right? And she gets really like frustrated about it, and she's like sitting there trying to do it, and she gets worked up. And to somebody else on the outside looking in, that seems like something super minute, but to her, it's a really big deal because she wants to do it, and she can't do it on her own, right? And so what she does is she'll be sitting on the ground doing that, and Becca or I will see her, and we'll ask her, "Baby, do you need help?" And she's gotten to where she can repeat some phrases, and she's learned some new words, and so with the cutest little look on her face, she'll look at us and go, "Help, help?" We're like, "Yes, help. Bring it to mama, bring it to daddy, we'll help you," right? And then we help her, we'll get the buckle almost fastened, and we'll let her close it, right? However, sometimes Autry will try to be stubborn and independent and try to do it all on her own, which just leaves her in the floor frustrated, right? And instead of bringing it to us, she's like, "No, I got this. I can do it on my own." And she keeps on going, and she just can't. She's not there yet, all right? She's not there yet. She'll get it one day, but not yet. Sometimes, though, we don't even have to prompt her. She'll identify that she needs help, and then she'll bring it to us so we can help her. We don't have to tell her, "Hey, bring it to Mama Ray today." She'll just be like, "Hey, I want to fasten this." She'll bring it right to me. In a lot of ways, we are just like little Autry. Sometimes we think we can do this thing on our own, or that maybe God won't be interested in hearing from us or helping us, right? But what we need to be like is when Autry just brings it right to us. "Hey, I can't do this on my own. I need your help, Mama. I need your help, Daddy." That's how we need to be with the Father. Because I don't know if y'all have figured this out yet or not, but you can't do this on your own. You weren't meant to. You were never meant to. God is actively waiting for us to bring our needs to Him. He doesn't expect you to be able to do this alone, and He wants to hear from you because He cares for you deeply. Bring whatever that is to the Father today. And that leads to my third takeaway, which is this. It's a little long, but hang with me. When we pray, we can come to God confidently, knowing that He will provide us with what we need. Now that Jesus has given us examples of what not to do, He's going to tell us what to do. Look at verse 9 through 13 here. He says this: "Pray then like this: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have also forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." If we look closely at Christ's prayer model, we can see it moving in a clear direction from imminence to intimate. What do I mean by that? Well, first of all, it's this. We're praying to God, transcendent, all-powerful, almighty, the creator of all, the Lord of the universe, the sustainer of all things, right? But how do we address God? Look at what Jesus says in verse 9. Our Father. Because at the same time, He is our Father who is concerned for our every need and cares about us deeply and intimately. There is no need too small that you can't bring to God. He wants to hear from you. That same God who spoke everything into existence and commands all of creation is available to us personally and actively engages in relationship with us. The key difference between the prayer of the hypocrite, the Gentile, and the Christian is who is being prayed to and what heart is behind that prayer. For the Christian, Jesus outlines what a genuine prayer should look like. Let's break it down. We remember God for who He is. Verse 9, our Father in heaven. We remember God for who He is. He is our Father, the one who is in relationship with us, yet we remember His status as the one in heaven. This communicates our love for Him and our recognition of His position as all-powerful. Hallowed be your name. We honor God for who He is and what He has done for our lives, and that word hallowed carries with it respect. Respect for of knowing that this is who God is and this is what He has done for us. Hallowed be your name. Honoring God. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Our hearts yearn for the coming of the kingdom of God. Right? That's what we look forward to as believers when we wake up every day. God, I can't wait for you to return. I can't wait for you to come back. I can't wait. We yearn for that, for the coming kingdom of God, and for the Lord's will to be done in the lives of men as they seek to live obediently to the Lord. In other words, until you do come back, Father, please make our lives and this earth, do your will here on this earth as you do it in heaven. Allow us to share your name with those around us, and may they come to know you and begin to act according to the way that you have called them to, living obediently for the Lord. Then we have these three that are going to go together. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, if we have also forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. These three are ultimately united in the understanding that we rely on God daily for our every need, physically, spiritually, and morally. And that daily reliance on God for all of these keeps us in proper relation with God as we seek Him daily in our lives and seek to share Him daily with others. And as we read on in this last little bit, what we're going to see is that Jesus reminds us of something incredible here. He actually comments on what he just said in verse 12, forgive us our debts if we have also forgiven our debtors. He continues in 14 and 15 and he says this, for if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. For some of y'all, that may be hard to read this morning. But Jesus reminds us that the chief evidence for genuine faith is that the one who forgives those who sins against them, that they would do that. As a believer remembers that they have had their debts wiped completely clean. A truly repentant lifestyle results in a spirit that is willing to forgive. And Christ makes it very clear that believers should have a spirit of forgiveness for others. It reminds me of the spirit of unforgiveness that I carried for years, even after I became a believer, for my father. Now, I'm not going to get too deep into detail, but my father walked out on my mother, myself, and my sister when I was very young, all right? And he did some things that I never had forgiven him for. And even after I had become a believer, I held on to that hate, that hatred, that disdain for him for years. And even after I became a believer, right, and I found out all that God had done for me, all that God had forgiven me for now and everything that he was going to forgive me for, I still held on to that because I was justifying it in my own mind. Of course I don't have to forgive him. Look at everything he did, right? Yeah, God forgave me, but he doesn't understand this, right? He doesn't understand everything that I've held on to during this time. Luckily, though, God worked on me. He worked on me. I went to counseling for over a year to figure out how to deal with how I felt for my father. This is before Becca and I knew that we wanted to have kids. Right up until that point, I was like, I've got to figure this out. I've got to figure this out. And through that, God walked me through this journey of learning what forgiveness looked like in my life. How not only to forgive, but how to live it out. And what I realized during that moment is that deep-rooted hate and things that I was holding on to didn't really affect my dad as much as I would have liked for it to, but it affected me and my spiritual life because it was as if I was waking up every single morning taking a dose of poison and expecting it to harm him, but instead it was just affecting me. It was just affecting me. And when I forgave my dad, I remember the weight that lifted off of me. And can I tell you now, all right, we just went and spent hours at my dad's house for Thanksgiving. God is good, all right? He is good, and he has redeemed that relationship, and he's continuing to. And it's not perfect yet, all right? I don't know that it ever will be, but it's better than it was. And God worked in my heart for me to be able to forgive him, and he's been working on my dad too, all right? Y'all continue to pray for him. When we hold on to that bitterness and that deep-rooted resentment, what we do is we're showing the entire world that, yeah, God has forgiven us, but I don't have to be like him. When that's exactly the opposite of what God calls us to do after we become a believer, but it's to walk with Christ, modeling Christ's life in our own and walking as closely to that model as possible. John Stott commented this, once our eyes have been opened to see the enmity of our offense against God, the injuries which others have done to us appear by comparison extremely trifling. Once our eyes have been opened to see what God has done for us on the cross, everything else that's ever been done to us seems minor in comparison. May we carry a spirit of forgiveness in us as we walk with Christ. I'll close with this. Hypocrisy in prayer is a misuse in which we divert it from the glory of God to the glory of ourselves. The error of the hypocrite is that he is selfish and that he seeks to elevate himself. The error of the Gentile is that he was obsessed with mindless babbling and mechanical sayings that meant nothing. But the prayer of the Christian should be God-centered, praising him for his glory, thanking him for what he did for us on the cross, and leaning on him for our every need. May we heed Christ's warning this morning and follow his example by coming to the Father authentically in our prayers. And for the one who is here that does not know God, he has made himself completely accessible to you. Scripture tells us in John 3:16 through 17 this: For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn it, but in order that the world might be saved through him. To come to Christ, all you have to do is repent of your sin and trust in him as Savior this morning. Will you do that? Let's pray. Father God, now we thank you for who you are, Lord. Now we thank you that even though we didn't deserve it, Lord, you looked upon us and you loved us and you took on flesh and you walked among us. Father, you experienced life alongside of us. God, and you paid the penalty that we could never pay by dying for us on the cross and rising from the dead. Father, as we think about that this morning, Lord, may we remember to lean on you every single day of our lives. God, may we continue to pray to you daily. And Lord, set the example. And God, continue to walk in the model in which you have called us to walk. Father, I pray for every believer in the room this morning, Lord, that you would convict their hearts, God, if they don't have a personal prayer time with you. And Lord, that they would enter into that. And Father, convict mine too. Lord, for anybody in the room that doesn't know you, God, I pray you would lead them to you. And Father, remind them that access has been granted to you directly through Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for all these things, everything that you are for us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.